Yes, I think it's good that the students realize we have two kind of theories when a judicial decision is just. We concentrate today, I think, on the Pistorius case, and I want to look at it from a procedural angle. We have two theories in law, procedural justice and material justice. And I like to focus from a sociological point of view on the procedural aspects, and when can you say that this procedure in the Pistorius case is just? And procedural justice has three dimensions: robust decisions, or the rectitude of decision, the cost and time.
Okay.
And the idea is that every legal system must find a compromise between the two. We want to have, let's start then with the rectitude of decision. When is it robust? Robust means it cannot be changed all the time. It should be there for a couple of times. A certain period of time. And here Pistorius is a very complicated case, right? Because it's in the courts already for a couple of years. There's an appeal pending. And that's not a good thing, because people think, what does the legal system produce?
Certainty.
And certainty.
Certainty.
And if it doesn't produce certainty, people start to think and be critical, and what do judges do? And that is important, because we must have good judges. They must know the relevant rules, and they must know the facts.
Yes.
But finding the truth about facts is difficult. And judges are not truth finders, because the law is not a scientific discipline who find out the truth. The judge, even the Supreme Court, the Constitutional Court, cannot say what really happened in the home of Pistorius when he shot the lady. So what the law has some other things. It is, it must have fair procedures, there must be equal treatment of the prosecution and the defendant, we must have good law of evidence, and that, I think, is very important, laws of evidence, because the judge cannot say, I don't know what happened that night in the prison, so go on with your life, because we expect him to make a decision. So rules of evidence are very important.
And this is what we'll be covering in the next theme, in theme 5.
Okay. So we don't have to look at it now.
Yes. Yeah.
And then we have time. So rectitude of having a rectitude of decision, and then we have time. Mm-hmm. Every legal system struggles, how can we deliver judgments in time? Mm-hmm. We have the famous expression, justice delayed is justice denied.
Sorry.
When it takes too long, the evidence is lost, people don't remember what happened 6 years ago. Some witnesses have died, so you must be quick in a certain way. And that is where the legal system has a lot of problems.
So, but what is the balance between trying to do the right procedure, therefore going very slowly, very meticulously, and then delaying?
Yeah.
So where is there a tension between the two?
And there is an eternal tension, and it is we must have competent judges who strike the balance. That they, at one hand, they allow the defendant to say whatever he wants to say,
yes.
And it takes some time.
Yes.
But at the end of the day, he should also say, this case will be closed within a certain period of time. Okay. Last but not least, if you win a case, let's say 20 years later, what are the benefits? If you have a land dispute and after 20 years you win, but in the meantime you have been impoverished, it is not a good thing. So there is this eternal tension, as you rightly point out. Then we have the costs. Law is not, we don't have a free legal system, we don't have a free education system, and we don't have a free legal system. So there are costs involved. Costs of the court, fees of the lawyers. And that is an important issue. is there really equal access to the law for people here in South Africa and in the Netherlands?
Absolutely.
And there is a big difference, of course, when you're wealthy, when you can hire the most experienced lawyers, or you have just if you can't afford one yourself, you get a legal aid lawyer, or you cannot have a lawyer yourself.
It also goes beyond just the lawyers, it's also about the experts. If you don't have money, you can't bring the most experienced experts.
You're right. Mm. Experts cost a lot of money, they don't work for free, and if the court doesn't pay them, the parties have to pay them.
Absolutely.
And last but not least, that you have also the civil procedures after, if you've lost the case, you also have to pay expenses for the other party. So that makes it even more complicated and costly. And let's now move to the custodial case. Can judges be neutral?
Good question.
Yeah? And especially if you have a highly publicized court procedure where everyone speaks. The one says he's guilty, he should be life in prison. The other say, no, he's a hero of the country, he should be lenient, he's been punished already enough.
He's disabled.
He's disabled already.
It's the first time.
It's the first time. Mm. Is there a chance that he will do it again? Mm. All these principles, these legal principles, they float around in the media. Mm. People have their own opinions. The whole question is the law colorblind. Mm. Would it be different if he had a black girlfriend, the color of the judge? Every argument seemed to count in such a high-profile case, and everyone can give his opinion. And the judge said, this is not a court of public opinion, it's a court of the facts.
Yes.
Well, and then we know. Is the judge, does she know more than anyone else who was in the courtroom all the time? Of course not.
No, they're listening to the same evidence, the same law on paper.
And then some professors come in the news, say, oh, it's clear, it's murder, and so here we have a big issue. Mm. What especially is the status of judges? Can we trust them? Mm. Are they good enough? Mm. And there we have also a question, a difficulty of legal education.
Yes.
Do we have a scientific discipline? Mm. My answer to that is no.
What do you mean by scientific?
That you mean that you have a discipline that makes progress. For instance, medicine, they prove that they can heal certain diseases.
Yes.
Now that they could not do 10 years ago.
So you see a difference.
Yeah.
This was a problem, it is resolved. The patient is healed, for example.
And it is in the Soviet Union, it is the USA, and it is in South Africa.
Yeah. Scientific laws are the same.
Yeah.
Yes.
And we have universal principles in law.
Yes,
but
we do.
But they do not apply everywhere at the same time.
Mm.
And that, so there is no scientific progress in law. There are no scientific methods in law.
Is that a bad thing though? Should law be scientific?
Well, no, it is. But the law, the lawyers and the law, and we as educators, should make clear to our students that law still is important.
Yes.
Law is a normative discipline, it is not scientific, so, but they like, professors like to present themselves as scientists, law is a science, and that misleads the public, so we should not do that. And then, how can we get legitimacy for the legal procedure if it's not a scientific discipline?
Yes.
Because, and then we are in big trouble. And there is a big debate, what is the best system? And that's why I like to compare the Pistorius case to the O.J. Simpson case in the U.S., a very famous sportsman who was accused, who killed his wife.
Yes.
And in the U.S., you have the jury system. Mm. At the end of the day, it was a very lengthy procedure with all kind of witnesses. And
publicized,
everyone gave his opinion. But at the end of the day, it was the jury of 10 ordinary people who were in court, who heard all the evidence, and they are the ones who say guilty or not guilty. And they said not guilty.
Mm.
And what you see there, if the jury has gave the ordeal, the game is over. The procedure is over. It is only once, it is yes or no.
Yes.
In Europe, some people say we should adopt a jury system.
What is the position in Netherlands at the moment?
We don't have it.
Okay.
But we have populist parties who say, these lawyers, they make things complicated, ordinary people doesn't understand. Mm. There's no equality before the law because ordinary people doesn't understand. If you have a jury system, you see, these are ordinary people from the street, the neighbor can be in the jury.
Yes.
And the good thing is, the legitimacy of the jury system is very strong.
Yes.
It ends up the whole thing. But of course, who are against it? The lawyers. These ordinary people, they don't understand the legal procedure.
Yes, complicated. We must
keep it complicated because... But the downside of that is that cases go on and on and on, as the Pistorius case.
Yes. Appeals over appeals over appeals.
Yeah. And who are the benefactors? The lawyers.
But when you go back to your question of legitimacy, in a country like South Africa or the United States of America, where there are still racial divisions, class divisions, would you say the jury system will bring about legitimacy? People will still say no, but there were 6 black judges, juries as opposed to 10 white, so legitimacy will always be questioned.
Yes, it will be questioned, and that's why in the US, then, that is a vulnerable aspect of the jury system. The selection of the jurors becomes a procedure.
Yes, yes, yes.
They ask you, do you have a racial bias? And everyone says, no. But if you have, at the end, 10 black jurors for a white defendant, and vice versa, so... And as we all know, in the US, the whole movement of Black Lives Matter,
yes,
it is an issue. And there are no easy answers,
yes,
but we must teach our students that to think about it. Mm. And so I'm not saying you should adopt the jury system, but there are some serious advantages of having it in terms of closure, of handling the procedures, and that is an advantage, but it should be weighed against disadvantages. Okay, is broadcasting on TV? That is meant to be open to the public. Nothing is happening in the hiding, which
yes,
is good.
Courts are open courts.
Open courts, public courts. But if after every day a professor is telling, oh, it's clear now, Pistorius is a murderer. Mm. And then the next day another professor said, oh no, the evidence was not enough. You confuse the public.
Yes. Yes.
All these commentators.
Yes, yes, yes.
We used to have the old principle, if a case is sub judice, if it's under the judge, no one should comment. That is over as soon as you televise.
Is that a bad thing or a good thing?
I think it is a mixed bag.
Yes.
The good thing is, but at the end of the day, I think we will end up with rules for commentators because...
Mm. Yes, 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 yes. We have to.
Some of them are paid by, so they are not all objective, they are paid by the defense or by the prosecution, so
yes,
it is, you have 2 trials, one on TV and one in the courtroom.
Mm.
So there should not be too much disjunction between the two. Okay, why is the legal system so complicated? And I think it's important for our students. We teach them law is a good thing, equality, transformative constitutionalism, all these nice things. But we should also teach them that lawyers are there for their self-interest.
Hmm.
Especially attorneys, they are private entrepreneurs. It's a business. It has become a business.
Hmm.
And we should teach our students from the beginning the business aspects become more and more important.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the lawyer's side, and then the judge's side. In Europe and America, there is a strong movement toward case management.
Yes, yes, yes.
Let's say in the law offices, in the commercial law offices, everything is managed by professional things.
Who are not lawyers? Sometimes who are not lawyers themselves.
Not lawyers, they hire an accountant or...
project managers.
Yes, and because everything has to be counted by the minute.
Yes.
You see the judges are lagging behind. They are just sitting there in their robes and they say, oh, we know everything.
Mm.
They have difficulties of delegating certain tasks to the clerks.
Absolutely.
They want to know everything. So there are two sides. Both the judges and the attorneys play a role here. Are there any solutions? Because our young students say, okay, problems, but okay, but we want to see solutions.
Absolutely.
Yeah, let's look at some solutions. Simple laws. Chepo, let me ask you one question myself. Do you believe it's possible to make laws more simple?
I hope so. I think the language is too complicated, you know, just from the language themselves. But also, the procedure and the way they write the laws is too complicated.
Mm.
But I don't see how you can make it simple.
Yeah. But it's up to us, right? We must train the lawyers of the future.
Yes.
Be simple. Use language that people can understand.
Yes.
Don't make it too complicated.
Yes.
Introducing time limits, that you just say a procedure is not allowed to take longer than 4 months.
But cases are different. Differs from case to case.
Okay. You are already spoiled by the legal mind, right? Every case is different.
Yes.
Let's look at this case by case.
Yes.
That is one of them. If a doctor says, if a patient comes in, oh, every case is different, he cannot operate, right?
That's a science.
That's a science.
That's
so,
a science, yes.
So we have to balance on
yes.
that, and it's not easy.
Yes, yes.
Limiting lawyers' fees, could that be a good idea? So because lawyers now have an interest to lengthen the procedure, to appeal and review cases.
Mm.
It's not easy, because law is a liberal profession.
Mm.
The state tries to get control of the advocacy, but it should not be too easy for the government to control the advocacy.
No, no, Mandela.
Because who helps you if you are accused of murder or you are accused of being a pedophile?
Yes.
You are. Everyone knows, this guy should go into jail for the rest of his life.
Mm-hmm.
And there's one person who protects you against the state.
Yes.
And that's the lawyers.
Yes.
So they should not be controlled too much by the state. But what of some of the lawyers, they act as accomplices of criminals. Yeah? They use their privileges to help criminals.
Mm.
We don't like it.
Mm.
So there is a tension again.
Yes, yes.
And the political parties, of course, they want to control. We don't want the lawyers to be too lenient towards criminals.
Yes.
But I think we should teach our students, it's not a good idea that we have an advocacy a bar which is controlled by the state.
Yes, yes.
We should defend it.
It must be independence and autonomy. Yes.
Yeah. So we started with these three dimensions: robust decisions,
yes,
costs, and time.
Yes.
And so the government always looks at the costs and the time.
Yes.
For instance, there are proposals to limit appeal.
Mm.
For certain cases, only one, you can only go to the magistrate court or to one court and not appeal. And that could be an exam question for our students.
Yes.
Why is it not a good idea when you want to have expedient judges to limit appeal?
Mm-hmm.
Let them think for a moment and then we give the answer.
Before we end, Prof, I want to go back to the issue of the law being a science.
Yeah.
Now, you are known worldwide as an expert in sociology of law. You've done work in Europe, you've done work in Rwanda, you're doing work in South Africa.
Yeah.
Are they the same? Law as a science and sociology of law. What is this thing called sociology of law? What does it contribute to the issue that we've been talking about?
Okay. Sociology of law delivers a so-called external perspective to the law.
Mm.
We look how laws are created, how legal procedures are produced in society.
Mm.
And that's not only look at legal sources, look at political sources, look at economy, at new technology.
Mm.
And also we look at what are the effects of law. Is law contribute? What are unaffected, unintended effects of the law?
Yes.
So I don't pretend sociology of law is a science, but it offers an external perspective to the law that is important. For instance, what we discussed about the self-interest of lawyers. If you start a law firm, you can start as an idealist, but at the end of the month you have to pay your personnel and you have to pay your rent. So this tension,
yes.
We should teach the student both sides. But before we close, I think we should also give the students an answer to the question, right? So they can think. So why is the answer no to limit appeal? Why do we have an appeal system in the legal system? It is to, and now the students must write to their notes, did I find the right answer? An appeal system is a way to review mistakes in the first instance.
Okay.
Because if the law itself must have a system to redress mistakes.
Yes.
Because if the legal system cannot produce just results, if they allow judicial mistakes to continue, there is no residency. So the law itself must produce a review, must review mistakes. Because if it doesn't do that, because miscarriage of justice, and we all have them. You have them here, we have them in the Netherlands, we have them, we see them in the US. If you have too many miscarriages of justice, ordinary people don't believe the existing system is a just system. And we should teach our students to do the best to prevent that.
Thank you so much, Prof. I'm sure the students have many questions. I'm sure they would love to interact with you, but this is the best we can do under the circumstances. We hope to see you again next year, and all the best with the future.
Okay, I'm looking forward to cross the minds again with you and with the students. Thank you for having me here.
Thank you.